So till now in our discussions in nuclear physics, we have talked about nuclear sizes, nuclear models, nuclear reactions. A good question that you might ask is, how do we come to know all of this? How do we know about different kinds of nuclear properties? Do we have some kind of a microscope that we can just zoom into something and just look at the nucleus? That we can look at the particles inside the nucleus, what is happening inside the nucleus? No, there is no microscope powerful enough that we can actually look at objects so small as the nucleus itself. So how is it that we have gathered so much information about the nucleus? How is it that all this knowledge about nuclear physics has been obtained? To answer that question, we need to also talk about a particular technology which developed in the last 100 years that has helped us in gathering this information, all this knowledge about the nucleus of an atom in the first place. So, for example, let's suppose you want to be a biologist, you want to study biology, you want to study the microscopic organisms, you want to look at the cells and the bacteria and the viruses, then you need a microscope to look at them. Yes. If you want to be an astronomer or an astrophysicist, you want to look at the stars, the planets, you want to look at Jupiter in the night sky, you need a telescope. Yes. So what a microscope is to a biologist, what a telescope is to an astronomer, in the same way, accelerators are to nuclear physicists. So accelerators are instruments or technologies that help scientists gain information and gain knowledge about the structure and the properties of a nucleus. And also they help in even inducing different kinds of nuclear reactions or performing some kind of nuclear experiments. So what is a particle accelerator? To understand, let's go back almost 100 years to one of the very famous experiments performed by Rutherford and his team. So Rutherford and his team took an iron source which was radioactive and it was emitting alpha particles, and then they directed those alpha particles onto a gold foil. So when these alpha particles were directed onto the atoms of the gold foil, they experienced different kinds of deviations, they experienced different kinds of trajectories. And by studying these trajectories, Rutherford gave his very famous planetary model of the atom, in which he said that the vast majority of the mass is concentrated at the center of the atom, which is known as the nucleus. So from then onwards, we got an idea about the structure of the atom and the existence of the nucleus in the first place. So the experiment is quite simple. You have particles which are bombarded onto another target material, and by looking at the trajectories of these bombarding particles, we induce some information about the nature of the structure and the properties of the target material itself. Now, if you look closely at this experiment, you'll realize that the alpha particles are positively charged. The nucleus of the gold foil is also positively charged. They repel one another. So when a bombarding alpha particle comes near some kind of a target nucleus, it is repelled away from that particular nucleus because they are positively charged. Now, usually alpha particles which are emitted in spontaneous radioactive processes have energies of the range of around 4 to 9 mega electron volt. However, the Coulombic repulsion that exists between alpha particle and some kind of a large atomic nucleus can have a Coulombic potential barrier of the order of around 20 to 30 mega electron volt. So if you want to perform a nuclear experiment in which you want the bombarding particle to penetrate the target nucleus, if you want to perform an experiment in which you want the bombarding particle to break apart the target nucleus or induce some kind of a nuclear reaction, you want the bombarding particle to have sufficient energy to overcome this kind of a Coulombic repulsion. Yes? So how to do that? So you basically want to accelerate this bombarding particle so that it has sufficient kinetic energy to overcome this kind of a Coulombic barrier so that it can perform some kind of a nuclear experiment that you can use to study something about the nature of the nucleus. So instruments or technologies were developed in the last 100 years to do just that. So accelerators, quite simply put, are instruments that can accelerate charged particles like alpha particles or some kind of electrons or other kind of nuclei, so that these particles can be bombarded onto a target material, and then we can use the experiment to study the nucleus. These kind of systems are known as accelerators. So these accelerators or particle accelerators can be broadly classified into two categories: electrostatic accelerators and electromagnetic accelerators. So electrostatic accelerators are those accelerators that use some kind of a static electric field. So if you have a bombarding particle like an alpha particle, and if you put that particle in the presence of a static electric field and accelerate it because via that electric field, then such kind of accelerators are known as electrostatic accelerators. A very common example of an electrostatic accelerator is a Van de Graaff generator. And electromagnetic accelerators are those kind of accelerators in which you have some kind of a oscillating potential difference or an oscillating electric field, and some kind of a charged particle is accelerated by some sort of a mechanism using an oscillating electromagnetic field. Those kind of accelerators are known as electromagnetic accelerators, and you can have different kinds of examples in electromagnetic accelerators. For example, you can have cyclotron, you can have synchrotron, you can have betatron, linear accelerators, etc. All right. So the first three electromagnetic accelerators, cyclotron, synchrotron, and betatron, usually use some kind of an oscillating electric field in a circular manner so that the particle is revolving in a circle all the time. And in linear accelerators, the particle is accelerated in a linear direction. Now, in the next couple of videos, I'm going to talk about all of these different kinds of accelerators. I'm going to talk about their principle, their working mechanism, their advantages, disadvantages, etc., etc. So if you're interested in them, you should look up my follow-up videos. We can also distinguish different kinds of accelerators based upon the energy of those accelerators. So we can say that accelerators can be specified as either low energy accelerators, medium energy accelerators, or high energy accelerators. So if a particle accelerator can accelerate a particle from, let's suppose, 10 mega electron volt to 100 mega electron volt, then that is known as a low energy particle accelerator. If it can accelerate the particle from, let's suppose, 100 mega electron volt to 1000 mega electron volt, then that is a medium range or medium energy particle accelerator. If it can accelerate the particle greater than 1000 mega electron volt, that is a high energetic particle accelerator. Now, different kinds of energies basically is required for different kinds of nuclear experiments where we want to study different things. For example, accelerators can give us a lot of information about different kinds of things. So one of the very common uses of low energetic accelerators are scattering experiments where we basically want to study, let's suppose, the size of a nucleus. So if you want to understand what is the size of a nucleus or how the nucleus size varies with, let's suppose, the mass number of a nucleus, then scattering experiments basically give us a lot of information about the size of a nucleus, which is usually performed by low energetic accelerators. You can also use accelerators to get an understanding about the electronic states of the particles inside the nucleus itself. You can also use accelerators to, let's suppose, break apart a nucleus or induce some sort of a nuclear reaction. And you can also use accelerators, especially high energetic accelerators, to break apart a nucleus to its constituent fundamental particles so that you can study the fundamental particles which make up nucleus, or rather which make up matter in the first place. So depending upon the requirement, different kinds of accelerators can help us gather different kinds of information about the nucleus, the properties of a nucleus, induce different kinds of nuclear reactions, and also study the particles which make up nucleus in the first place. Now, I'll be talking about all of these accelerators in the forthcoming videos, but I just want to discuss in this video the general sort of a basic construction of an electrostatic accelerator. So here we have a basic construction of one of the most popular and widely used low energy accelerator, which is the electrostatic accelerator. So the construction and the working mechanism of this accelerator is quite simple. You basically have some kind of an ion source which is emitting some sort of a positively charged nucleus, let's suppose in this case, and you have some kind of a target nucleus, and these ion sources are directed onto the target nucleus, and there you have some kind of a detecting system, and then you study something about the nature of the scattering which took place. Now, this entire setup is placed in the presence of some kind of a external electric field by putting this entire construction in the presence of two opposite polarities. So let's suppose you have a positive polarity and you have a negative polarity, which is basically connected to some extremely high voltage battery. So if you have a positive polarity here and if you have a negative polarity here, these positively charged particles, let's suppose in our case, which were emitted and are going towards the target nuclei, will experience the electric field between these two terminals and they will get accelerated in this particular direction. So we can make a few calculations. So let's suppose that you have some kind of electric field here. We can calculate the electric field. So what is the electric field? The electric field is nothing but the potential difference V because of this high tension battery and divided upon the separation between these two terminals here. And the force experienced by these bombarding particles is basically equal to the charge of these bombarding particles. Let's suppose these bombarding particles are nuclei which has some kind of an atomic number Z. So the charge of that kind of a nuclei will be Ze, and if this kind of a bombarding particle is present in some kind of external electric field E, the force that it experiences is F is equal to Q E. All right, so this multiplied by E is nothing but this multiplied by V upon D. So what is going to be the total amount of work done as the charged particle moves in the presence of an external electric field from this point to this point? So the total amount of work done, W is nothing but force multiplied by distance. Yes, so this is nothing but ZE V upon D multiplied by D. So DD gets cancelled. You are left with ZEV. So this is the total amount of work done. That means this is the increase in the kinetic energy of this incident bombarding particle. So the amount of energy that this kind of a setup can provide to this kind of a bombarding particle is nothing but the work done, which is ZEV. The unit of this kind of an energy is nothing but in joules. Okay, if I want to convert it in electron volts, I'll basically divide this entire quantity by E. So if I divide the entire quantity in E, so this can basically give us ZV, but in units of electron volts. So the energy that is provided by this construction to these kind of incident bombarding particles is basically ZV in units of electron volt. So the amount of energy basically depends upon two factors. It depends upon the atomic number of the incident particle, and it depends upon the voltage or the potential difference between these two terminals. Now, as I already told you, the amount of energy needed to overcome the Coulombic repulsion between a target nucleus and the incident particle is of the order of mega electron volt. Mega means million times. So to induce some sort of a nuclear reaction or some sort of a high energetic scattering experiment, we need to provide energies of the order of millions of electron volts. So basically, we need to provide voltage differences of the order of millions of voltages. So you need an extremely powerful external battery which is capable of maintaining a potential difference of the order of millions of voltages to be able to create a system which can provide energies of the order of mega electron volt to this kind of an incident particle. So this system obviously has limits, because you cannot have infinite potential differences because of a battery. There is a limit up to which you can create a certain kind of a potential difference. So that is when different kinds of setups would use different mechanisms to create even further or greater potential differences, or to provide even greater amount of kinetic energy to the incident particle is necessary. So this is a general construction of an electrostatic accelerator, where the amount of energy that the incident particle acquires is dependent upon the external potential difference created by these two terminals. In the next couple of lectures, we'll be talking about the different kinds of even more complicated constructions which can be used to give even more further accelerations to these incident particles, and help us in studying different kinds of nuclear experiments. So that's it for now. I'll see you in the next one.